It's Wednesday night, and our subject tonight is predestination, and we're coupling that with atonement, because atonement means to cover something, to stain and indict. The word atonement is the word kafar in the Old Testament. Kafar means to cover, And in the Hebrew language, it's the same in the Greek. You have a noun, then you have a verb form of the noun. You have a noun in a verb form, and the noun is kofar. And this word kafar means to cover. Kofar means to stain or to dye. And when the Ark of the Covenant was stained and dyed, you had the temple, and then you had the, here's the brazen sea and the daily altar where all the sacrifices were offered. And you had the table of showbread. Nobody knows what it was shaped like. We just put it there. Then you had the altar of incense and the Ark of the Covenant. And then you had, on the outer sanctuary, you had the seven candlesticks. Well, what was later on built into Solomon's temple. Out here you had the brazen sea and that, of course, that altar. Our hearts are now the Ark of the Covenant because the law is written on fleshy tables of our hearts. And the Ark was sprinkled. Now our hearts are sprinkled according to Hebrews 10:22, and that was sprinkled with the blood of a goat that was offered here on the Day of Atonement, the 10th day of the 7th month. Well, the high priest would come in, go under or around the veil, and nobody knows how he went in there. He may have crawled under it. He may have gone in the side end of it. And he went in here and sprinkled the Ark of the Covenant. Now Jesus, the priest forever after the order of Melchizedek, comes into the temple of God, which temple we are, and goes through the veil, which is his flesh, and the flesh is the bread, and the bread is the body, and the body is the church. So we are the picture of the high priest coming in and sprinkling our hearts, and that Ark of the Covenant was the blood of the goat was covered, stained, and dyed upon that. And the equivalent of that in the New Testament is the word baptize. Baptized. And baptize is a Greek word. It's not originally an English word. Our word baptize comes from two words, babto or baptizo and babto. Baptizo and babto, both of these were incorporated into our word baptized. Since they did not have a word in the Greek language, and we didn't have a word in the English language to translate these words over to, so they anglicize. When you see the word Anglo or anglicize, to anglicize something means to make it an English word. They had no word to translate these over into, so they took this top word, changed the O to an E, and baptizo means to cover, and babto means to stain, and to dye has the same exact meaning as cover, the Ark of the Covenant. And he's washed us from our sins in his own blood. He does the washing. We do not wash ourselves. It is not by the will of the Ark of the Covenant that the high priest would sprinkle blood on it. It is not by our will that he washes us. He does the washing. We do not. There's no such thing as walk down the aisle and accept Christ as your personal Savior. There's no such thing as you being born again by your will. God does everything. Everything. Let me write this on the board. God is doing everything. People don't, even most of the predestinationists do not believe this. They don't believe God is, it's as though we were one big, huge computer program. And the thing that a lot of people resent, they say, that makes us robots. That's exactly what it makes us. If God writes upon fleshy tables of our hearts and then insists that we walk righteously, if He births us by His will, God has done it all. God does everything. It's just like the Ark of the Covenant being sprinkled. The Ark of the Covenant had nothing to do with whether the high priest is going to sprinkle it or not. The temple had nothing to do with whether it was going to be built or not. The bread had nothing to do with whether it was going to be bread or not. The candlesticks had nothing to do with whether they were going to be candlesticks. And the candlesticks represents the church there in the last verse of Revelation, the first chapter. God is doing everything. God creates evil. That's not something I made up. That's something that God said He does. He says, I, the Lord, do all these things. Look at that back over there in Isaiah 45 and verse 7. 45 and 7. I form the light and create darkness. I make peace and create evil. I, the Lord, do all these things. Now, when He's talking about that, the context of that starts back there in the previous chapter where it says in verse 24, Thus saith the Lord, thy Redeemer, and He that formed thee from the womb, Israel. He tells Jeremiah, Before I formed thee in the belly, I knew thee, and I ordained thee a prophet unto the nations, Jeremiah. He said, I did the forming. Now, I know your mom and dad thinks they did that, but they did not. I did the forming. If every person is going to be born by some particular great scheme of things, by what the Bible calls a cosmos, it's the same word as world in John 3:16. It means orderly arrangement. You mean God loved the orderly arrangement? Yes. He didn't love everybody. He only loved His wife, the church. That's why the Bible says, For God so loved. So is an adverb. Adverbs tell how, when, where. When, where. Sometimes they tell why. And they modify verbs, adjectives, and other adverbs. So modifies loved. So God doesn't love everybody. It tells how or in what fashion God loved the orderly arrangement. There's an orderly arrangement of all things. Even there's an orderly arrangement of the believer. God has arranged everything. He creates sin. People say, how can He create sin? Let me ask you something. Who planted the tree of the knowledge of good and evil in the garden? And who made hell? And who made heaven? Why didn't God just not make a hell? Why didn't God make every man perfect in the garden where he couldn't sin? Why didn't He do that? Because He didn't want to. The Bible says, having predestinated us unto the adoption of children by Jesus Christ to Himself according to the good pleasure of His will. He says, that's what I want to do. God wants sin to happen. This is what's amazing. God wants to create sin, and He wants sin to happen. If He didn't want it to happen, then why was our names written in the book of life? Names written in the book of life from the foundation of the world. From the foundation of the world. And why was Jesus the Lamb slain from the foundation of the world? What was He slain for? Husbands, love your wives as Christ loved the church and gave Himself for her. He was slain for the church, and the church, that is a particular people, that's not everybody. He didn't die for everybody. Husbands, love your wives as Christ loved the church and died for her, nobody else. So if he died for his church before the foundation of the world, then evidently he knew every one of them's name. Because he's not going to die for somebody and then put them in hell. He's going to be a substitute for his wife only. So he's the lamb slain, and he creates evil, and he created sin. Well, if he creates sin, is God a sinner? No. It's kind of like, it's the same thing if a husband and wife get together, say, let's have a baby. And so they have a baby, and as the baby grows up, it grows up and becomes very wicked and very evil, and it goes out and commits murder and shoots somebody and ends up in prison on death row. Does that mean the mom and daddy are murderers? No. They're not murderers, are they? God created, isn't that amazing? Man and wife can get together, have a baby, and yet they will hold it accountable for its sin. God births who he wills, and then he will hold us accountable for our sin. And he creates in sin to do sin. And when you have a baby, do you know that it's going to grow up and be a sinner? Well, then why do you do it? Because you want to, right? Because you want to have a baby. And you're going to spank it, and you're going to make it grow up and teach it to live and do right, aren't you? It's okay if we do this, but people say it's not okay for God to do that. Isn't that ridiculous? It's not okay for God to have the children that he wants. I quoted a verse a while ago, Ephesians 1 and 5. Having predestinated us unto the adoption of children by Jesus Christ to himself. That word adoption is the word huiothosia. It's pronounced a W. Huiothesia. Huiothosia comes from huios. And that is the word sons. And tithame means to place. When you're adopted, you placed as a son, not by your will, but by the will of God. Aren't you? So he places sons in his family. What about all of the rest of the people? They're vessels of wrath fitted to destruction. If you can't hear this, and you never want to hear this, you're a vessel of wrath. You were made to be taken and destroyed. And God doesn't love you, and he's going to put you in hell because he has the right to do that. God not only creates evil, he creates sin. People say, I can't get a hold of that sin. Well, look, he said, the Bible says sin is the transgression of the law. Well, who created the law? Who said thou shalt not kill? I think God did that, didn't he? And if he hadn't wanted there to be a law, then he could have said, everybody can live the way you want to, and nobody, if you want to break the law, that's your business. He creates the law, and he creates man out of corrupt dust. And then he says, and we know it's corrupt because Genesis 1:1, the Bible says God created the heavens and the earth, heavens and earth. And then it says in verse 2, 1 and 2, the earth became without form and void. Now Isaiah 45:18 says, God says, I did not create anything in vain. Now that word in vain is the word tohu. It means empty or worthless. Empty, worthless. He said, I didn't do that. He said, I didn't create worthless. Well, if in the beginning God created the heavens and the earth, and then the earth becomes without form, without form is the same word as in vain in Isaiah 45. It means worthless. So you have to have, there has to be an event happens between verse 1 and 2. Because he creates, that's a righteous word. Righteous, it's the word bara. Means to cut and make fat. Now fat does not mean what we call fat, cellulite, a big belly. I know it's not what it means, big fat on our legs. That's not what it means. Fat to the Jew was the richest of the crop, the leanest of the cattle, the best corn crops. That was called the fat of the land. So bara is a righteous word, and it comes from the word barith, which is the word covenant. So God gave us his covenant in verse 1 of Genesis. Or do you actually think what he gave us in his covenant was without form and void? No, sirree, it's not. So something happens between verse 1 and verse 2. We see without form and void and darkness, that's all the very nature of Satan. Darkness is on the face of the deep. That's all the nature of Satan. Well, then the Bible says in Revelation 12 that Satan was cast into the earth. Michael, the archangel, the 12th chapter, Michael cast a third of the angels into the earth. And these are the fallen angels. These are evil angels. Well, that is a that whole chapter is a panoramic view of all time. And the way you find out where Satan is casting the earth, you look back here and find the first nature of Satan. Where is it first mentioned in the Bible? Without form, void, darkness. That's the nature of Satan in verse 2. So God creates the earth out of corruption. Then he picks up this same dust in Genesis 2, picks up the same dust and forms man. He yatsar man, yatsar. He doesn't create man out of the dust. He forms man out of the dust. And he creates, David said, with his breath. He breathes into Adam's nostril breath. Breath is his creation. Adam comes in two steps. He comes by being formed of the dust, formed of dust, and the dust is corrupt, isn't it? It's corrupt. So when God forms Adam of the dust, whose will was it that Adam is formed of dust? It's God's will that he's formed of dust, isn't it? And it's God's will that he's formed of corruption. And then he forms him, and he goes, breathes into him the breath of life, and man becomes a living soul. And then he looks at Adam, who's made out of corruption, and says, I've got a tree over here you cannot eat of. Thou shalt not eat of the tree. Now, what's going to keep Adam from eating of the tree since he's made out of corruption? Not one thing. He didn't say, Adam, I'm going to give you a choice of the tree. He said, thou shalt not eat of it, and the day you do, you're going to die. Didn't he? He didn't say, if you eat the tree. He says, the day you eat thereof, you're going to die. Well, who created Adam? Out of dust. And who created the law of thou shalt not eat of the tree? God. Therefore, when Adam transgresses the law, the fact that God created him out of corruption puts a law in front of him and says thou shalt not, and you can't keep from doing it, then God created sin, didn't he? And then God's going to hold Adam accountable for it, just like when you have a baby. And you say, thou shalt not put your hand in the cookie jar, and the day that you do, and I know you will do, I will spank you. Don't we do that? You mean, is that okay for us to do that, and it's not okay for God to do that? Is that right? So God creates sin. Now, if God creates sin, He creates evil. Back there in that 45th chapter of Isaiah, He says, I make peace and create evil. Well, He creates sin, and He's going to hold man accountable, and He's going to call His people out of sin, isn't He? He's picked a people that He's predestined to be conformed. He's predestined His family. The Bible says, for whom He did foreknow. Whom He did foreknow. There's a people that God foreknew. The whom's, whose is the word. It's masculine gender. If it's masculine, it means it's a people. The people that God foreknew, prognosko, that's the Greek word. I had a lady call me this past week, and I listened, and I just started laughing.
Well, you just say that God don't, that Jesus didn't want us to be baptized in water, and Jesus said, this is my body, and you just don't know what you're talking about. He wants us to eat bread and crackers, and you said God didn't want this, and you're just teaching that Greek. You need to get you an English Bible.
Woman, you are truly an ignoramus. 2,000 years ago, there was no English. Didn't Jesus live 2,000 years ago? Was the Bible written somewhere around 2,000 years ago? What was the world speaking back then? Well, Greek. All the world was speaking some form of the Greek. Every city, state had a different dialect of the Greek language, and the Bible was written in the Greek. I got that Greek. One lady come here, stood out in front of the church one day, and she, after I preached and put all these Greek words on the board, she says, I don't need God. I don't need Greek. I need God. Okay. Gosh. There's the King James Bible comes from this. This is the Textus Receptus, the Greek on the top line, the English under it. That is the original Word of God. It is not English. English began developing about 1,100 years ago, as long after the death of Jesus. Now, when somebody says that, that's because you're ignorant. When I say ignorant, I don't mean that as an insult. Ignorant means unlearned. She's very unlearned. You just use that Greek. You need you an English Bible. Oh, Lordy me. Now, where was I? For whom He did foreknow, prognosko. That's the word. It's not foreknow, it's prognosko. It's not whom, it's whose. Whom He did foreknow, prognosko. He also did predestinate, prohorizo. That is the word predestinate. It's not predestinate. That's an English word. Forget that. Think prohorizo. That's the word. Of course, it's a construction of pro. And there are no H's in the Greek. This is the small letters here. And don't worry about the large letters. They're very seldom ever used. Learn the small letters. The Greek is written in the small letters right there. And there are no H's, but there's an H sound. It's called a diacritical mark. It has a breath sound. Ho. Rizzo, O-R-I-Z-O, means to bound. And how many times have I said this? It's not a mere simple boundary. It's a boundary of light because horizo is our word, horizon. So it means to pre, pro means, it's our word pre. It's the same thing as our prefix pre, so it means to before, determine, for the horizon, or for the light. So the people that God foreknew, He has predetermined for the light. that they would be conformed. Whom he did foreknow, he also did predestinate to be conformed. To be conformed is one word in the Greek. It's the word sumorphos. Got to put another M in there. Now here's what predestination is about. Without the last half of this verse, you're not going to understand predestination. Sumorphos comes from sum, means in fellowship, and morphe. Morphe means to be shaped in fellowship with, as we fellowship one with another here, we are fellowshipping with Christ, and we're going to be shaped into the image, the icon, the likeness of Christ. So, God has predetermined, he has predetermined that a family that he foreknew, foreknow comes from gnosko, means to know intimately. There's a family that God knew intimately beforehand, before the foundation of the world. That's why our names are written in the book of life from the foundation of the world. That is why he was the lamb slain from the foundation of the world. And these people only, this is God's people and nobody else. The people he foreknew is his children. It's Jesus' brothers and sisters. Brothers and sisters, he said, my brothers and my sister and my mother are those who do the will of the Father. That is conforming to the likeness of Christ. That's what this is about. So God creates our conforming. If you never conform to the likeness of Jesus, if you never conform to the likeness of Christ, you're a vessel of wrath, fitted for destruction, and you're headed for hell. Yet somewhere along the way, if God knew you, this has nothing to do with walking an aisle and saying, I accepted Christ. You can't accept Christ. Even all the people that have told me, I accepted Christ as my Savior. There's no such thing. That's an action on your part, isn't it? He births whom he wills. Of his own will begat he us. We were begotten by the will of God, not by a sinner's prayer. That is one of the biggest lies that's being told in the world by the preachers today. There's no sinner's prayer for salvation. The Bible says so. If it's a sinner's prayer, it's by your will, isn't it? We know that God heareth not sinners. If any man be a worshiper of God and doeth his will, him God heareth. Unless you're worshiping God and doing his will, he doesn't listen to a man who doesn't believe in him. When you're dead in your sin, you can't call upon a God. And everybody will, the most famous verse in all the Bible that all the Baptist preachers I was raised around are familiar with is Romans 10:13. For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. That's true, but read the next sentence. How then shall they call on him in whom they've not believed? Belief is the method of salvation, isn't it? Aren't we saved by grace through faith? Faith and believe are the same word. The only difference in them, one is the noun, the other is the verb. Believe shows the movement. It is an action verb. Action shows movement. When we believe, it's the movement of faith. Faith is the noun. Faith is the word pistis in the Greek. Believe is the word P-I-S-T-E-U-O. The stem of the word remains the same. I didn't make this up. That's in the interlinear. That's in the original text. The word ending is changed depending on some character of the word. So faith is a noun, believe is the verb. And faith cometh by hearing. And hear and obey are the same word. Hear and obey, same word. In Hebrew, it's the word shama. I can't even write. The hearing ear and the seeing eye, the Lord hath made even both of them. So if a man can hear, God has to create the ear that hears, doesn't he? And hear means to obey. God has to create the obedient ear, doesn't he? God creates everything. God creates evil. He creates sin. He creates an ear that hears. If you hear, you obey, and you start obeying the Word of God, then you start. It's God that causes you to obey His words. I'm merely an instructor up here. I've spent 58 years studying the Bible. I'm not new at this. And I'm here to tell you that if you do anything right, it will be God that causes you to do it, and it will not be you. Nothing you do is of you. Not even the sin you commit. Not even when we've all rebelled against God and gone out in the world. Nobody's rebelled against God more than me. I've been a pop singer. I've sang in clubs all over America. I've sang in colleges. Nobody's been more rebellious than I have. Nobody's been a bigger sinner than me. Nobody here. I know what sin is about. I know what's out there. You can't tell me anything about it. I was in it for years. So, God has to create obedience. Well, when you obey, don't you obey God's law? But what is the law? Something He created? Yes. If He created the law, He's going to create your obedience to it because He created the hearing or the obedient ear. What is His law? Well, it is over here in the Old Testament. Thou shalt not kill. Thou shalt have no other gods before me. Will you come up no other gods? Will you come up and do these laws over here? Well, you'll very gradually give them up, and that'll be self dying off over the years. We all have self in us. I want what I want, and I want it when I want it, and I don't care what God says. If you're that rebellious, He made you that way. Has anybody been rebellious besides me? I know you have. There's no temptation taking you, but such as is common to me. So whenever I will admit what sin has been in my heart and the wrestling I have with it, I know what everybody here is thinking. Do you know that? All you have to do is admit what's in your heart and you know what everybody else is thinking. That's all you have to do. If the Bible's true, you have to, when you know what you're thinking, you confess to God, oh God, I'm a sinner. I am worthless and God, all these things I've done, it's all my fault and I'm willing to take the blame, Father. When you come to that place and you know what you have in your heart and you can name the sin and name it off one at a time, people say, oh, yes, we all have sin. Well, can you name one? Well, no, I can't think of any right now. Yes, you can. You're just lying. Everybody can think of them. Just the thoughts you have. So self has to die in order to obey God, doesn't it? Well, the commandments, yes, we're kings and priests. Is the law done away with? No, we're kings and priests. A king offers acceptable, pronounces righteous judgment. A priest offers acceptable sacrifice. We give our bodies a living sacrifice. That's one of the commandments of God, isn't it? I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you give your bodies a living sacrifice, wholly acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service, and that will be a daily cross. And without a daily cross, you can't be my disciple. So if you're a priest offering self as a sacrifice, that comes a long time down the road after you start believing. You start believing and you have little faith, or oligos pistis, puny faith. And faith is death to self, and it has to grow. It has to grow, and when faith grows, self decreases. He must increase and self decreases in our life. So Christ becomes larger and larger in our life. Faith increases as you grow older, and self decreases. So if you have faith, faith is the gift of God, not of works. We're saved by grace. Grace is the word charis. It means favor that is unmerited, something you did not do to deserve eternal life. Nobody did anything to deserve eternal life. You can't walk down the aisle and accept Christ. The Bible says so. But the Bible says that the natural man does not receive spiritual things. 1 Corinthians 2:14. The natural man, psukikos, P-S-U-C-H-I-K-O-S. That's the physical man. The man of the senses. The sensual man. And what are the senses of a man? Well, he can smell, he can see, he can taste, he can hear, he can touch. That man does not receive spiritual things. The Bible specifically states that. Receive is the word dekomai. It comes from the word dek, which is the word 10 in the Greek. A decade is 10 years. A decalogue comes from deca, and logos. Logos is the word. Deca is the word 10. That means, decalogue means the 10 commandments. 10 commandments. Dekomai means to reach out the 10 fingers and accept any spiritual offer that's been given. The Bible says dead men cannot accept anything spiritual. Dead men do not accept Christ. I don't care how many preachers out here are saying it. My father said it. He was a Baptist preacher. My father was as ignorant as like the old saying goes, dumber than a tractor seat. He was just dumber than a rock. My father did not know anything about the truth. Now, I'll tell you what. If I will call my own father down, a Baptist preacher down, believe me, I'll call down Billy Graham. Because what he says is absolutely not true. The Bible doesn't say, accept Christ, pray a sinner's prayer. Does not. How many preachers are preaching that across the country? Nobody I know of. That crept into the church back in the 1800s. Those things are not true. If you don't believe, and belief is obedience to God's word, faith cometh by hearing, and faith is a gift of God that God puts in the hearts of all of His elect, and nobody else has faith, do they? Let me just put this on the board again. If you have faith, you can't come up and say, I believe God, I believe in God. Belief is obedience to His word, isn't it? Isn't it? So, believe, faith, let me put it this way. Hebrews 11 and 1. Here's the best definition of faith in the Bible. The best one in the Bible. Faith is. It's going to tell us what it is, isn't it? Faith is the substance of things hoped for. Substance of things hoped for. It is the evidence of things not seen. Instead of is, can we put equals? Here's what faith equals. Now you can't come up and say, I believe God. That doesn't mean anything. If God hasn't put in your heart substance and evidence, you don't believe, because believe is the same as faith, isn't it? Believe is merely the verb form. So believing God is having the substance. Believing God is having the evidence. And if you don't have the substance and evidence, you're not a believer, are you? No, sirree. And belief is the method of salvation, isn't it? I guess one of my favorite verses. My father would preach along with all of his Baptist preacher friends, and they would beg people to walk down the aisle and come and accept Christ as your personal Savior. Accept Christ as your personal. And you know what that bothered me? And nobody, I walked the aisle 100 times trying to accept Christ. I knew it wasn't right. I knew something was wrong. I couldn't figure it out. When I was 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, I kept walking the aisle. I walked the aisle about 100 times. My father dipped me in water about 8 times, plus about 4 or 5 other preachers. I couldn't figure out, why can't I feel this and why can't I get this? It wasn't true. I'd like to have my dad back and say, Daddy, that's not true. I did tell him one day in my den, I said, Daddy, your easy gospel is not true. And I turned to my mother, who played piano and organ for him. For 55 years, I said, Mama, it's not true. You have to repent of sin. Daddy, you have to repent. Dropped their head to the floor, stared at the floor, and would not comment to me. And I said, and I must repent. If there's no repentance, there's no salvation. Repentance, metanoia, means to turn from self. Metanoia. It means to be turned. So God creates turning, doesn't He? Isn't that what He does? God creates turning. Repentance. He creates repent. Except you repent, you'll all likewise perish. Unless God turns you. Lord, turn thou me and I shall be turned, Jeremiah said. And after I was turned by God, I repented. You can't be saved without faith. Faith is the gift that God puts in the heart of all His elect. And that's the grace of God. That's the charis, the unmerited favor. He picks out who He wants to be His. And He picks out the one He doesn't want to be His. And He says, these are vessels of wrath fitted to destruction, and these are mine, and every one of you will come to me. All that the Father giveth me shall come to me, and I'll drag them in. John 6:44 says, no man can come to me except my Father has sent me. Draw them. The word draw is the word halko. It means to drag in. God has to create your coming in. Creates His sheep to come into the kingdom. Nobody can come in except my Father which has sent me. Drag them in. The word is drag. The same word used in John 21 that Peter threw out the fish net and drug in the fish. If God doesn't drag you in, you're not going. And you mean He'll drag me against my will? If He waits for your will, you don't have any will. You got self-will, but no free will. That's not true. All you have is a will to sin. That's what the Bible says. There's none good, not one, none righteous, none. There is none that seeketh after God. Nobody seeks God. God had to come after me and beat my brains out. Has He ever beat your brains out? Huh? Beat me up? I know I'm not the only one here that He's beat up. He says, I scourge every son I receive. We don't receive Him. He accepts us. We've been made accepted in the beloved. He said, this one's mine. You're coming to me. Follow me. Come here. Well, if you're obedient to His commandments, if you're obedient to His commandments, you're going to obey all of His commandments. He has imperative moods in the Greek. And every time you find an imperative mood, that's a command. I found out, I learned what an imperative was in elementary school about 1947, 48. I found out, I remember one of my elementary school teachers saying, children, we have 4 types of sentences. We have a declarative. A declarative is a statement, and it ends in a period. Ends in a period. Jim went to the store. Then you have an interrogative. Interrogative is a question. You interrogate someone, you question them. That ends in a question mark. Did Jim go to the store? And then you have an exclamatory. I remember my teacher telling me this. Well, I remember it. I don't know. I just remember a lot of things. Exclamatory ends with an exclamation point. Jim went to the store? He said he wasn't going. You put an exclamation point. And then you have an imperative. Here I am, 10 years old, my mother, well, I wouldn't do much of what she said. My father would say, Jimmy, go to the store. If he said that, you can believe that was a command. That's what an imperative is. Now, you have the same thing in the Greek. You have imperatives. And imperatives are commands. Well, isn't that obedience to the law of God? If he creates the hearing ear, he creates your obedience, he gives you something inside that causes you willing to be willing to hear and understand. The elect understand these truths. People say, how in the world can you have the truth, Jim Brown? You have so few people here. Well, that's another truth. Few are going to come into the narrow way, and many are going into the broad way. Most people in the world are going to hell. Few are coming in. And few are going to be given ears to hear, and few are going to be commanded by God. So if he says, if he gives you an imperative mood over in the Old Testament, wouldn't that not be God creating? If he's created the hearing ear, he's created the obedient ear. So if he gives you an imperative mood in the New Testament, was Jesus the God of the Old Testament? Well, yeah, he was. He said before Abraham was, I am. Said that to the Pharisees. They said, we'll kill you for that. You calling yourself the I am God of the Old Testament? We'll kill you. And they finally did. So he's the same God that said, let there be light. Well, did the light say, I don't know if I want to be? Did the light say, give me an invitation hymn, sing just as I am, and I might decide by my free will to be? When God gives a command, it is so. He not only commands his people to come forward, he commands every vessel of wrath to be in hell one day. You can't even go to hell by your own will. You have to go to hell by the will of God. Every imperative mood would be the hearing ear. That would be to obey God, wouldn't it? Obey and hear, and faith cometh by hearing. So if you have faith, you're going to do the things that God says, aren't you? Huh? I just give a few of these imperatives. One is the word agonizomai. Another imperative is the word tapinao, T-A-P-E-I-N-O-O. Also, you have the word ekleno. Agonizomai is our word agonize. It's the same word Jesus used when he said, strive to enter at the straight gate. If you believe God, then you're going to be striving. You're going to be agonizing over sin. The inner man that's been birthed in you is going to be agonizing about the way you live. You are going to be agonizing. That's not something I'm telling you you have to have. That's something that God says, if you're mine, you will be obedient to me, and you'll be agonizing over sin. When the Bible says, humble yourself under the hand of God, that's the word tepanua. Humble. You're going to humble to God and be obedient to his word and do what he says. You're going to cut down self. The word means to level self. You're going to cut down self somewhere in your life. You're going to become humble to God, and you're going to obey his word. Yo, you may not be humble to men. People think humble is being a sissy. I'm just a pansy, and I'm just a Christian. No, humble is just like Jeremiah. Just like Jeremiah walked through the streets of Jerusalem and said, judgment's coming. He'd stand at the gates of the city and say, judgment's on its way. And they said, that Jeremiah is such a smart aleck. He's so cocky and arrogant. King Zedekiah, can we kill him? He said, you can hang him in the mire. The mire was the human feces in the dungeons. That was their septic system. Hang him in the dungeon. When the Lord would tell Elijah, go and stand before Ahab. Tell him, there'll be no rain for 3.5 years. He stood up before the great king of Israel and said, there'll be no rain. 3.5 years without rain. Goodbye. And he left. And boy, they got so mad at him. They thought it was Elijah that stopped the rain. And Jezebel, Ahab's wife, said, I'll kill him by this time tomorrow. When you're humble to God, people are going to hate you. You're going to be bold, speak out. I'm not afraid. I told a lady on the phone yesterday. I said, she called long distance watching us on TV from somewhere. She said, I said, I don't cut anybody any slack. She said, you sure don't. I didn't cut my father any. I don't cut my mother any. I don't cut my wife any. I don't cut my son any. I don't cut my daughter any. My daughter's 53 years old, and she don't want a word that I say. I hadn't seen her in 27 years. But she hates this message. You'll either hate this message or you'll love it. One of the two. There is no middle ground. Not when you tell people God doesn't love everybody and he may not love you. If he loves you, he'll scourge you and chastise you until you're obedient to his word. And he knows how to humble his people. Ecclesia means to avoid. He says, whenever anyone comes preaching any other doctrine, he says, to mark them which cause divisions and offenses that are contrary to the doctrines that ye have learned, and avoid these people. Stay away from people who don't believe God's word and truth. Now that's a command. If you're a true believer, you'll come to a place and say, I'm sorry, but I can't run with you. I can't run around with you and go where you go, and I can't marry you, and I can't date you, and Mom, I can't run around with you, brothers and sisters. If you don't believe God and you got all this squirrely, goofy-faced doctrine, I'm not going to be around you. I don't run with anybody that don't believe God. I preach to everybody out in public. I witness everywhere I go every day. Well, if you belong to God, you're going to avoid false doctrine. You're going to humble yourself. And you know how many of these we've got? You say, do I have to memorize all those Greek words to be able to do that? If you belong to God, he'll write it in your heart whether you ever understand the Greek or not. All I'm doing is making it clear what we have to do. So he writes, he creates his commandments in our hearts. He gives us the hearing ear. Do you have faith? I've always got people saying, well, my family believes God, my mother believes God, my father believes God. No, they don't. If they're unwilling to hear these truths, they do not. Let's see if they have them. Let's see if they have faith. Faith is the substance of things hoped for. Substance is the word hypostasis. Hypostasis comes from hupo, meaning under, and stasis means to stand. Does your mother have an understanding of the Word of God? Does she have that? When you say somebody is a believer, don't use that term loosely around me, because I'll ask you some questions. Do they believe in a daily cross, self-denial, death to self? Do they believe in being hated by the world? Do they believe in being men separating from their company for words that's coming out of their mouth? Well, people separate from me. You can believe that. They don't like what I'm saying, because I'm saying that Christmas is paganism, Easter is paganism, along with Valentine's, along with Halloween. They're all the same system in different cultures under another name. I'm saying that you have to have a daily cross, and that's not your choice. When God says he's predestined his family to be conformed, the ones that he foreknew, they're going to be placed inside the light, and that's Jesus. They've been pre-Jesus, and if you're placed inside the light, you're going to love the truth. If you don't love the truth, you're going to hell. You cannot be a so-so. Well, I'm halfway on and halfway off. Somewhere in your life, you have to love God enough to speak the truth out of your mouth and be persecuted for. He said so. If the world hated me, it will hate you. If it persecuted me, it will persecute you. Did the world hate Jesus? Well, they killed him for what he said. If you love God, he said, you'll keep my commandments. Keep tereo doesn't mean to do them all. It means to guard them against loss. You'll say, God has written them in my heart, and I may never be able to do them all, but I know they're true, and I'll fight for them. Let's see if you have. I have people, so even people that come to Grace and Truth,
My mother's a believer. My father's a believer. Well, they're doing Christmas. Well, yeah. Well, they believe in free will. Well, yeah. They said they accepted Christ. Do they believe in predestination? No. Do they believe in death itself? Well, not really. Then they don't believe God. Now, faith is, here's what you'll have. You'll have an understanding, won't you? Because that's what the word substance means. Substance does not mean stuff. That's not what it means. It's the word hypostasis, understanding. If you understand, you will learn, won't you? Now, is your mother learning the Bible? Is she hungry enough? Blessed are they that hunger and thirst after righteousness. You have to be hungry for truth. Only the ones that hunger after righteousness. Now, when you hunger after righteousness, you won't care what people think. I don't care what my mother thinks. I don't care what my kids think. Don't care what Mary thinks. Don't care what anybody thinks. I don't care what you think. I care what God says. That's all I care about. And if you hunger after righteousness, you'll be filled. But if you hunger after righteousness, you're not going to care what people think, because righteousness is something you must do. And that's obedience, isn't it? 1 John 3 and 7. Be not deceived. He that doeth righteousness is righteous. You can't go to heaven without doing right. The word righteous comes from the word right. It's the word dikaiō. D-I-K-A-I-O-O-S-U-N-E. Dikaiōsune is the word righteous. It comes from dikaiō. D-I-K-A-I-O-O. It uses the word justify. And it means to render innocent. You have to be rendered innocent of your guilt and of your sin, because He has shed abroad His love in your heart. He has sprinkled your heart with the blood of Christ. And a blood baptism was a death. It was a martyrdom. If you're not dying somewhere daily in your life, you're not a believer. It's, people throw that word belief around so easily. You have to have understanding. If you understand, you're going to learn. A learner is the word mathetes. That's the word disciple. If you're a disciple of Christ, He says you're a learner, and you're learning the word, because faith cometh by hearing, and hearing and obeying are the same word. So if you have faith, you have understanding, you're going to learn. That's a disciple. And Jesus said, he that beareth not his cross and followeth after me cannot be my disciple. You can't be a learner without a daily cross. Where does a cross come from? Is that being behind on your rent? No. Is that losing your job? No. You had to be condemned to a cross in the first century. Only slaves and criminals could be put on a cross. Roman citizens couldn't be put on a cross. You had to be condemned to a cross. And Jesus said, you have to take your cross daily. Otherwise, you can't belong to God. Somewhere in your life, you must have a daily cross. If any man will come after me, and let him deny himself. Op or naomai, utterly contradict himself. Oh, by the way, op, A-R-N-E-O-M-A-I, that is an imperative mood in the Greek. He's not asking people to deny. He's saying, anybody after me, I'm commanding you, deny self and take up his cross. Take up is the word A-I-R-O. By the way, that's also an imperative mood. He's the same God that says, let there be light. If he says, take up your cross, deny self, contradict self utterly, that's not a choice that you make. He has to create, God has to create, we said he creates the turning, creates turning and repentance. Well, if he creates the hearing ear, then he has to create, take up cross. He has to create, deny self. I'm not here to tell you to deny self. I'm here to tell you what God said, to utterly contradict yourself. Somewhere, you say, how do you do that all at once? You don't. If God starts working on you, what he does, you start off life with a whole lot of self and very little Christ. You've got an inner and an outer man. The inner man is Christ in you that God birthed in you. And the outer man is self. And that inner man will demand that self die. And most of what you have in you is very little faith, oligos pistis, puny faith. And you got a whole lot of contention and strife and arguing and pride and arrogance. And the list goes on and on. And the longer you live, Christ puts you through fire, trials, affliction, tribulation, and he makes you give up one day. God made me give up and say, Lord, the fault is mine. Please forgive me. I'll quit trying to be rich. I'll quit trying to be famous. I'll quit trying to be somebody, and I will follow you from now on. I don't care if I ever get any applause the rest of my life. Everybody wants to have applause. So if you deny self, God has to create that self-denial, doesn't he? God has to create everything. You're not going to deny yourself on your own. Try it. I think I'll just quit living for me. Oh boy, I like that car, I like that girl, I like that guy, I like that diamond ring. I want that job, I want that education, I got to get that house, I got to get this car. And nobody's saying you don't work for a living. Whatever you do, do it all in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, all in his name, his onoma, his authority, his character. And do it all with all your might, work as hard as you can, and do it to the glory of God. That's what the Bible says. And by the way, those are imperatives also. So as you live through life, faith will grow and self will die. Self has to, when John the Baptist said he must increase, I must decrease, that is years of affliction and trial and fire. God has to ordain the fire, doesn't he? He has to create tribulation, fire, trials. I'm not telling you have to do this. I'm merely a conduit speaking the word of God. God says this is something he's requiring of every one of his people. If you'd have told me this when I was 25, I'd say, go fly a kite. You think I'm ever going to live that way like a nut and like a fanatical old man? Like Jim Brown's going to be in the future? If I could have met me when I was 25 or 30, I'd have looked at me as a 30-year-old man and said, you are nuts, mister. Yeah, nobody can live that way, holy and godly and righteous. And as an old man, I'd have reached out at Jim Brown and slapped him across the face and said, you fool. Because that's what I was. You don't know what a fool you are until you get old. And then you say, Lord, I don't even know if I'm getting it right now. We can't do anything. You can't do anything godly. Or even Paul, a writer, he wrote 13 books. Some say 14. Some say he wrote Acts. I don't know whether he did or not. Nobody else knows. But Paul wrote 13 books at least, 14, one more or less, of the New Testament. And he said, as a believer, how to perform that which is good, I can't find in me. If God doesn't work in me to willing to do of his good pleasure, I won't do anything right, and neither will you. I'm just here as an instructor saying, if you're having a hard time in your life, that's God. And if you belong to him, he's making you give up. And it might take him 30 years, but you will give up.
If you're one of His elect, He's going to conform you. The fact that He's going to conform you to the likeness of Christ, He has to create your conforming. Well, what was Jesus like? Well, He believed the Father. I always like to put it up here. I'm not through with this. That He has to cause faith to grow in your life. And the longer you live, as you go through fire and trials and tribulation, self will decrease and faith will continue to increase. Besides all this, give all diligence, add to your faith, and He named seven things there in 2 Peter 1 and 5. And by the way, the word add is an imperative mood. Welcome to the world of God. The word add, besides all this, give all diligence, add to your faith. He's not asking you to add. Epikoregeo is the word. I've tried to say this to you. When God predestines us, I wrote something down on an old paper up here. I was saying on, it's an old paper I run across. I said, when the Bible says the people that God foreknew, He's predestined them to conform, He did not predestinate you to give you an opportunity to choose Him, like I heard some preacher say. He had chosen us in Him before the foundation of the world that He might give us an opportunity to choose Him. That is not true. That's an out-and-out lie. He's chosen us in Him before the foundation of the world to be conformed, or that we should be holy and without blame. He chose us. I wrote on that old paper, I found this. Jesus did not predestinate. He did not wish we would come. He did not predestinate everybody because He did not atone for everybody. The cross He bore was not for everybody. It was for His wife. Predestination is not a plan that you allow God to perform in your life. I like that. It is not your choice. John 15:16. You have not chosen me. I have chosen you and ordained you. Along with my choosing of you, I've ordained you to go and bring forth much fruit. So that's not our choice. Nothing is your choice. Going to hell is not your choice if you go. That's the choice of God. These are called vessels of wrath fitted to destruction. Romans 9:22. They're called natural brute beasts made. The word made, genea, means born. Born to be taken and destroyed. Most of the world are vessels of wrath going to hell because God wants them there. God don't want everybody in heaven. Can't you just picture God just walking up and down the corridors of heaven going, I just wish I could get y'all to do what I want you to do. It bothers me. I'm only God. I know you got free will and it's stronger than my sovereign will. Please. Is that a sissy God? That's a goofy God. I don't even want to serve that kind of God. Crying and weeping. The God I serve gets what He wants. He says, I've declared the end from the beginning. And from ancient times, everything that's not yet done. He's doing everything. Saying, my counsel shall stand and I will do all my pleasure. I'll do everything I want to do. I'll send men to hell that I want to go to hell. And I'll save the ones that I want. And that's all. And nobody's getting by with nothing with God. What do you think the devil is? An independent God, an independent creature? He is God's devil. That's what he is. He can only do the evil that God wants him to do, and that's all. When Satan comes before Job there in the first chapter of Job, and he says, Job, and Satan says to God, and God looks at Satan, he says, have you considered my servant Job? How escheweth evil? And Satan said, there's no wonder he does that. You built a big hedge about him. You made him the richest man of the East. More cattle, more asses, more sheep than anybody in the East. He's the richest man there is. If you'll turn him over to me, he'll curse you and die. God says, he's in your hand. Don't you study. He said, he's in your hand. Don't you touch his body or his life. Do you understand me, Satan? He says, yes, sir. And he goes out, and the Sabians come in and fall upon the sheep and take them all away.
and the fire of God falls from heaven. Not the fire of Satan, the fire of God falls from heaven and consumes the asses and the slaves, and they're carried off by the enemy. And after it all happens, Job's 7 sons and 3 daughters are in a house, and the wind blows the house down. And people say, well, the wind is of the devil. Insurance companies know wind is not of the devil. Insurance company calls hurricanes acts of God, don't they? Huh? Is that what they call them? Acts of God? Sure they do. Well, the wind blow, if you go to the 37th and 38th chapter of Job, God tells Job, the ice is mine, the snow is mine, the rains are mine. If somebody gets flooded out, I did it. The lightning bolts report to me for duty and say, where shall we strike? You, God, would you like for us to strike that warehouse over there and burn it up? How about hitting this man on a golf course like happened here some years ago up here at Gallatin? You think that lightning bolt was under any other instruction but God? He had that man walk right into the spot where God was going to have it strike. So he manipulated the man's mind. He does everything. God speaks to inanimate objects and says, fall, and it falls. There's not a sparrow that falls to the ground that God is not in charge of. And he says, the very hairs of your head are numbered, and they have a number. I know every number. And when one falls to the ground, I know which one it is. But because I arranged it. God's doing everything. If you do righteousness, it's God. If you don't do righteousness and you hate the Word of God, that's God too. When you don't believe God, and you don't believe it's God doing it, that it's God doing it in you, not believing Him. Unbelief is of God. Because He doesn't want everybody. He doesn't love everybody. He's not taking everybody to heaven. He's not wringing His hands, pleading and begging people to come. He looked at Matthew and He said, follow me, akulatheo, imperative mood, command. He didn't invite Matthew. So He creates a daily cross. And when He said, follow me, if any man will come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross daily and follow me. That word follow is akulatheo. And that is an imperative mood. So He creates following, doesn't He? Creates following Christ. And that word follow, akulatheo, means to be in the same way with. So He creates the narrow way for His elect, and He creates the broad way for the non-elect, for the vessels of wrath. So you can't even get into the narrow way. Narrow is the word thalibo, and that is, it comes from the Greek word thalipsis. Thalibo means to crowd through a narrow opening. And thalipsis is the word tribulation. We're going through tribulation from these vessels of wrath that hate us. That's the crowd that's going through the broad way, and they're pressuring us as we go through the narrow way. And we must, through much tribulation, enter the kingdom of God. Being a believer is one of the most wonderful, miserable lives you can live. It's wonderful knowing the truth. I wouldn't trade what I understand about the Bible that God has taught me for 58 years. I started studying when I was 17. I wouldn't trade it for all of the money in the world. I would not trade the understanding of what God's given me for all of Bill Gates' money. He's got $68 billion. He's got $1 million 68,000 times. I wouldn't trade one point of what I understand about Scripture for all of his money. Bill Gates gets to keep that for another 20, 25 years, and then he's going to die and be in hell. How do you know that, Jim Brown? How do you know he hadn't repented? He's not taking a daily cross, is he? He's not talking about death to self and self-denial. All he talks about is money. How hardly shall a rich man enter the kingdom? If the righteous scarcely be saved, where will the ungodly and the sinner appear? The word scarcely is the word molus. It means with great difficulty. It is difficult preaching this truth and living in it, isn't it? Yeah. When you start telling people that Christmas is pagan and Easter is pagan and God doesn't love everybody and He only loved His wife, the church, and that's a few and that's not many.
Lord, are there few that be saved? He says, strive to enter at the straight gate. For many, I say unto you, will seek to enter in, but will not be able. So God has to create the few, doesn't he? Few. Let's get back to where we were. Don't come telling me. My mother believes God. She goes to a Baptist church. She says you're kind of a cult, but she believes God too. She doesn't believe the God of the Bible. She believes another Jesus, another spirit, another gospel. Paul said the world is going to be preaching another spirit, another Jesus. But he comes up and says the other Jesus is Satan transforming himself into an angel of light. That's who the other Jesus is. I keep asking you this. How in the world can Satan deceive dressed in a red spandex suit with horns and a red tail and hooves on his feet? Now, who's that going to deceive? Oh, let's follow Anton LaVey, the head of the Church of Satan. All the Christians are going to go after him. Sure. Anton LaVey wasn't the guy that was fooling people. It's Billy Graham. Anton LaVey, you remember Anton LaVey, the head of the Church of Satan? Anton LaVey was a circus. Had a picture of Christ. You had to walk over the picture of Christ as you walked into his church out there in California. I don't mind walking on that Christ because that's not the Jesus of the Bible. The Jesus of the Bible says, take your cross and die daily. Death to self. Self-denial. Be hated by the world. You're not going to be hated by the world for preaching an easy, slushy, mushy gospel that goes on the Baptist churches, the Pentecostal churches, the charismatic churches. They're not going to hate you there. Does everybody go around talking about, well, these Pentecostals there and these charismatics and these Baptists, they're all lying? Nobody says that. They get mad at me for saying they're lying. Don't they? They don't say they're lying. They all like each other. They have different ways to heaven. The Baptists say, accept Christ, sinner's prayer. The Church of Christ say, be dipped in water and eat crackers and grape juice and call it communion, and that way you get to go to heaven. But you have to be dipped by a Church of Christ preacher. They won't accept a water dipping by a Baptist preacher or by a Pentecostal. You have to be dipped by a Church of Christ. The Baptists won't say, accept anything else either. And the Catholics say you got to eat the body of Jesus to go to heaven, but you can't eat it unless you're a Catholic, and you have to be baptized in the Catholic Church, and you can't partake of the Mass unless you're a Catholic, and you can't go to heaven without it. And they all believe in holding hands with each other, but they all believe in a different way to heaven. Don't they? Please don't come up and tell me, if you come to Grace and Truth, that your mother's a believer and she doesn't like anything I'm saying. I'm going to the original text. If what I'm saying is not true, there's no truth. If I define the words from you, you say, I don't believe in English. And I say, well, let me get Webster's dictionary here. Let me define some words. And everything I define, you say, I don't believe that. I don't believe it means that. Then you don't believe the English language, do you? If I'm taking these Greek dictionaries and I'm giving you the meaning of the original word in the text and the culture and the customs, the idioms and the metaphors of the Greeks and the Jews and the Romans in the first century, if you don't believe that, then you don't believe the truth. If what I'm saying is not true, there is no truth. You can't do definitions and say, I don't believe that. Then you're ignorant. You are. If you refuse to believe it, you're stupid. Stupid is the word ba'ar in the Hebrew. It means dull of hearing. It's the word that's been translated brutish. It means you have the understanding of a brute beast that will not learn. You just will not learn. And you cannot learn. Ignorance, the word brutish in the New Testament is allogos. Logos is the Greek word. Placing the alpha in front of a word negates the word. It means no word of God. A man that's stupid. And it means dull of hearing or stupid. So if you're dull of hearing, you have no faith. You're dull of faith, since faith cometh by hearing, and that's obeying God, isn't it? Well, let's see if your mother has faith. Faith is substance. Substance is hypostasis. Comes from hupo and stasis. Understand, and a learner is one who understands. You have to be learning if you understand. That's a disciple. And Jesus said, if you do not bear your cross daily and follow after me, you cannot be my disciple, you cannot learn the Word of God, you cannot understand, and you do not have faith. Because faith is substance,
and that is believing. So if somebody says, my mother believes God, does she understand the Word of God, and does she take her cross, and is she crucified every day because she's going out and telling people the truth? Jim, do you have to do that somewhere in your life? You do. You can't go to heaven without a cross. And crosses are commanded by God. Any man come after me, let him deny. That's an imperative command. And if he that hath an ear to hear, let him hear, let him obey. So we're going to obey his words somewhere along the way. You may not do every one of them, but you're going to try to understand and learn and obey the Word of God. Somewhere in your life, you're going to take a cross. You're going to stand and say, I believe God in opposition to my mother. My mother was as sweet and gentle, quiet little old lady you've ever seen in your life. She just didn't believe God. She's a Baptist preacher's wife, played piano and organ for him. I'd say, Mama, let me tell you about predestination. Jimmy, I won't have that. Don't you talk about that around me. If you talk about that, I'm going to make you get out of the car. I was riding along the road with her. And she's this quiet and gentle person, never heard a cuss in my life. She never smoked a cigarette. She never told a dirty joke. She's a sweet little lady that didn't believe God. Because your mother's a sweet little lady, Jesus didn't come to call the righteous but sinners to repentance. You have to be a self-confessed, 100% bona fide sinner. And you have to know it. And you have to believe that. And if you ever know that you're a sinner, that you've got a dark, evil, wicked heart, only God will reveal that to you, won't he? Only God can reveal who he is and who you are. And if you ever get a vision of who you are, you'll cry out to God like I've done, like many of you have done. Say, oh God, the fault is mine. I am so sorry. And Lord, I'll quit blaming everybody else. I'll blame myself from now on. In fact, look at that one more time over in Luke, the 10th chapter, Luke 10. So if your mother doesn't bear a cross and she don't believe these words and she doesn't, if she hates the truth, if she hates the fact that I'm saying Christmas is Christ Mass, Christmas is Roman Catholicism. Look here in Luke, the 10th chapter. The Bible says that God hides the Word of God from whoever he wants to, and he reveals it to who he wants to. That word reveal, when you find the word reveal, it's the word apokalypto. Apokalypto comes from apo, meaning a removal of kalypto. And that word is the word cover. God takes the blinders off of the eyes of the people he wants to. If a man comes alive in Christ, we are not born again by our will. We're born not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but of God. If he quickens anyone, the action comes from him, Z-O-O-P-O-I-E-O. It comes from zoo, or zoon, and poeo. Zoon means alive. You go to a zoo to see living animals. Poeo means to make. Means to make alive. That's the word quicken. And Jesus quickens whom he wills in John 5:21. If you're ever alive in Christ, he has to do it. You don't have anything to do with it. Well, do I walk down an aisle? No. We don't give invitation hymns here. When I get through teaching tonight, I'll say, let's pray. That's it. If the Holy Spirit don't deal with you, I am not going to try to. I don't believe in invitation hymns. God didn't invite anybody to come in. He commanded Matthew, follow me. He commands us, take your cross, die daily, follow me. And we will be in the narrow way. The narrow way is not your choice. The daily cross is not your choice. Holiness is not your choice. Godliness is not your choice. Because when we're talking about holiness and godliness and righteousness, we're talking about the Greek word with the meaning of the first century. I think the Bible was written in the first century, wasn't it? It has the same meaning. I've had people call and say, we don't live 2,000 years ago. I know that. That's why we've forgotten it. We have to go with what it meant when Jesus had it written down. God says, I change not in any of my judgments. The word change is shana. It means I do not duplicate. I don't have another meaning.
I do not transmute a meaning into something else. It means the same thing it meant 2,000 years ago. That's why we go to the original text. I teach the Greek words, the Greek alphabet. I'll teach you the alphabet. I'll teach you how to learn. And most of the people that come to Grace and Truth know all the words I'm saying, don't we? How many times have I said these words? 1,000 in a year? 1,000 would be a conservative estimate, wouldn't it? I'll say them so many times that you'll get a hold of them. And then you get around somebody, where'd you get all that foreign stuff, that Greek? We don't need Greek. We need the Lord in our life. You mean kurios? You mean you need the Lord? Kurios means to rule. You mean God's ruling in your life and He is your Lord without your obedience to Him? He's not your ruler. He's not your Lord. You can say, He's the Lord of my life. I believe in Jesus. Do you believe in a daily cross? We can't do that today. We live in America. What about being hated? Well, no, we live in a Christian land. No, we don't. This nation is no more Christian than some bug looking for shelter out there on the parking lot. This is not a Christian nation. This is Babylon. Babylon was founded on self. Let us make us a name. Is America trying to make itself a name? Is everybody trying to make themselves a name by their car, their house, their things, their stuff? Is America involved in idolatry? Yes. Covetousness is idolatry. Covetousness, then in Ephesians 5 and 5, in Colossians 3 and 5, covetous is the word pleonectes. And that is idolatry. Pleonectes means to want more. If you've ever wanted more car, more house, more stuff, more things, more carrots in your diamond ring, more of everything, and you're not content with such things as you have, you're an idolater. Well, I've been an idolater. Has everybody else been one? If you say you hadn't, you lie. We've all wanted more, hadn't we? More than what God has given us. It takes a long time to be content with such things as you have. Paul said, I've learned in whatsoever state I am therewith to be content. And he said that when he's in a Roman jail waiting to have his head cut off. Isn't the world something? Now, if you believe God, you're going to take your cross somewhere in your life. You're going to add to your faith. And it names seven things you have to add to your faith. And that will take a lifetime for that to happen in your life. If you believe God, it's not, you don't say, I believe God, but that's for Sunday. No, it's not. It's not for Sunday. If you take your cross and die, and that's believing because that's obedience. Well, a daily cross comes by telling people truth, and that comes by telling truth out in public. In public. Well, that's called witness. Witness, and a witness is the word martus, and it comes from the word martyr, and a martyr is one who dies. You can't be a witness without speaking publicly and saying something and dying daily out in public. Paul said, I died daily. Now, if you're going to be like Christ, it's not something you're going to do. Are you? God's doing everything. He's doing all the good and all the evil, and He's holding us accountable for the evil. So if you're going to be like Jesus, He tells us to be perfect. And by the way, that's an imperative mood. Be perfect. You mean, now, here's a real good example there in the 6th chapter of Matthew. Here's a real good example of taking the English word instead of the Greek word. And that's what people do. Why ain't nobody can be perfect? No, you can't be perfect. Why, the English says that. So God don't really mean that part there. Duh. It's not the word perfect. It's the word teleos. Or it's the word perfection, teleotes. It means to be complete or completed. So if we be perfect, we're being completed. Well, what is that? That's adding to our faith.
That's taking our cross daily. And as we get older, and after you get to be about 60, you're going to say, I need to live right. I don't need to live the way I've been living. And when you're about 40, you're going to say, I really am trying not to go after self, but I still want that car and that house. I'm not saying don't get a good car. I'm saying when you long for that which is forbidden, that's called lust. Lust is the word epithumia. It means to cover your life with thumos. Thumos is breathing hard after. When you breathe hard after something, you're saying, I got to have that thing that I can't afford, so I'm going to get me two or three jobs so I can get that car. I just got to have it. I got to have that girl. I'm going to do everything I can to get her. I got to have that guy. I'm going to do whatever I can to get him. If I have to go to bed with him, sleep with him, get him and get pregnant by him, I'll do what I have to do. I've got to have him. That's what lust is. I got to have a car I can't afford. I got to have a house I can't afford. I know all about houses people can't afford. I sold real estate for years. I'd go out into Hidden Lake out here, big rich section of Hendersonville. I'd go into a house and someone would say, well, our furniture's not here yet. We don't have any furniture in the living room. And we don't have any in the den because it's not here yet. It's being delivered. And the house has been vacant except for a bed in the bedroom. And they're strapped to the hilt trying to make the $1,800 payment on it, going, working three jobs each. And they can't afford furniture for the living room. I've seen that many times. What a miserable way to live. That's called lust, isn't it? God is doing everything. Welcome to the world of God. All your evil. The wrath of man shall praise thee. Psalm 76 and 10. The wrath of man shall praise God, and the remainder of wrath shalt thou restrain. David said, the amount of fury and rage that man has will praise God. How would it do that? Well, he'll raise up evil men as swords to cut people like me to the ground. And he did that for years in the music business, in real estate. And I blamed them until God put me in the hospital with IVs in both arms. I said, God, I surrender. Those evil men were swords in your hand, and you cut me down with them. And he will make you surrender. He'll make you give up. You might be in a bed with IVs in your arm. He might make you a quadriplegic if you're elect of God. You may be real stubborn like I was, and he'll make you give up. If you belong to him, he will. And if he won't, he'll just harden your heart and harden it and harden it, and he'll put you in hell because that's where he wants you to go. People think they can go to hell by, they think, I can just go away and forget about that. If you forget about it, God ordained that. Did you know that? That you can't get away from the will of God in your life. If you go out and do evil, he ordained that. And then he's going to hold you accountable for it. Well, that's something, isn't it? Whatever is going... You see, when we live miserable in our lives, he's ordained that. He says, don't you get it? Well, let me make your life more miserable. He just piles the misery more on top of the believer, more on top of the elect. And he says, you really hadn't learned to understand. You got to surrender to me. I'll keep on doing it until you throw your hands in the air at about 40 or 45. Say, Lord, I give up. I surrender. Please, God, don't hit me again. And you'll be big, brave, strapping, big, strong person thinking I can whip the world and he'll make you say uncle. I love what Spurgeon said. He said, Charles Spurgeon said, God says, you will come to me. You say, I will not. You say, you will come to me. You say, I will not. And God just puts you through living hell on earth for about 25 years. And you say, Lord, save me or I perish. And God says, I knew I could make you say that. I like that. Because God knows what he can do to our lives and make us say. This ain't choice. You don't choose to go to hell. God chooses it. Every choice that you make, if you go out here and you turn right, you say, I made that choice. God made it in your mind before the foundation of the world. He caused you to turn right. If everything in your life is the will of God, and he said, we have obtained an inheritance, being predestinated according to the purpose of Him that works all things after the counsel of His own will. He's declared the end from the beginning, from ancient times, everything that's not yet done. All the evil that's going on, all the evil that every one of us will go out there and do, that's the will of God, and He's going to beat us and make us come away from that evil and make us bow to Him if we're elect. If you belong to God, He's going to turn you loose on your sin and say, go to it. If God pulls His restraining hand off of His elect people, they'll go do the most evil, wicked deeds. I have done that and been there. You can't tell me about life and sin. Been there, done that. I tell you what, the happiest I've ever been is when God broke me and crushed me in the hospital. I went right to death's door twice, once at 37 and once at 44. It's the best thing that ever happened to me. That's why when we look back, we can say, and you're not going to understand Romans 8 and 28. We gave you Romans 8 and 29, but you won't understand Romans 8 and 28 till you get older and go to hell and back about 500 times like I have. And then you'll say, we know that all things work together for good to them that love God, to them who are the called according to His purpose. I can look back at my past now and say, I know why God was doing to me what He was doing to me in 1967 and 68. I was dying. I thought I couldn't live another day, but I did. Now I look back, and the things that I thought was life and death, it's like, what was that, a feather? Was that a drop of water? Somebody dropped on my head. That's what you think it's, I can't get through it, God. I just got to have fame. I got to have fortune. I got to have my way. And why can't I have it? I believe in You. I did not. I wasn't obeying Him, was I? I was obeying self. And finally, He just beat the tar out of me and put me on my back. And I lay in a bed dying, got down to 118 pounds. I'm crying, oh God, deliver me. I got back up, went right back to what I was doing. Ended up in the hospital after just ripping and raring in real estate. And I was a big hot shot. I was going to be somebody. Everybody's going to know who I am around here. I'm going to make myself a name in this town and in this county. And I did. And while I was doing it, I was grinding my health into the ground. I ended up in the hospital and said, God, this is You. You're killing me. You're going to kill me if I don't stop and live right and behave myself. What God makes us do is makes us realize it's Him doing it. And then He has to do something in our mind, and He throws a little switch back there and goes click. You're going, I give up. I surrender, Lord. Always reminds me of Cool Hand Luke. Always reminds me, boy, when I think of it, remember Cool Hand Luke, the old movie? And he says, Luke, get your dirt out of my hole. And he got there digging. He digs it out. He says, what's your dirt doing on my boss's ground? And he digs it back. He digs it, and he says, what's your dirt doing in my hole? And he digs it out. He does it so many times till he just wore out, and he falls down in front of the boss, and he says, don't hit me again, boss. You got my mind right. But that is exactly what God does to His people. He will beat you and make you dig that hole, make you put it back in. He'll put you down with everything, divorce, and with cancer, and with you name it, and He'll do it to you. He says, I beat my children, and I beat them when I do. I beat them mercifully so they will live for me. I'm going to beat sin out of mine. But everybody else, it's not being beaten out of them. He's given vessels of wrath a hard time on earth, and He's going to give them a hard time forever in hell. Let's pray. Father, thank You for helping us to see that You create everything. Teach us that, Lord, even the evil that we do and the sin, You created it, and You're going to hold us responsible for it, and You're going to beat us for it. Cause the believers to recognize if they ever live right, it'll be You that does it. And when we live wrong, it's You that's making us miserable. And we will never be straightened out as long as we live for self. Thank You for Your truth. Deal with our hearts. Crush us under Your hand. You said we have to be crushed to belong to You. We'll praise You for all the things that You're doing, which is everything. We'll give You praise in Christ's name. Amen. Well, I'm sorry, but that's the way it is, folks. That's life, as the old song says. That's life. That's a hard message, isn't it? God will come get you. God will get you if you don't behave.
I hope for it,
though.
Huh?
I said I hope for it. Ah, yeah, me too.
We both work at the same company, so...
Do you?
Telling the truth there is...
Well, you can go talk to them about it, can't you?
Oh, we have quite the heathens there.
Huh?
We talk to all of them about it all the time.
Do you?
Yeah.
What's the one thing?
You should leave it.
But it's the truth.
Fine. For a little bit.
Well, if you change this one.
That's right. That's exactly what I
want.
So you think so? If you have a desire, give me
a chance to quit.
I turned right before and I quit.
There you go.
It's a hard message. It's not just speed.
Set. Oh, okay. Like, hey, you guys go to 10 gospel. We're like, on a Wednesday? That is awesome. You know, it's truly amazing. Church, instantly. That was the,
he was all kinds of stuff.
Now that he knows that you're so ecstatic about it, he just can't let you go to Tennessee. That's why I'm wearing a shirt. But I just didn't have time to get home. Like, I have on my phone. I have like 30 messages. Earplugs to the phone and plugged in the truck. I can just play them in the CD player.
Yeah.
And
they don't care.
It was just absolutely a CD player. You hadn't left yet. Yeah, there were pretty, some of those old, probably the audio quality, the neural ones are just going to improve. Oh, I mean, there's nothing wrong with it. There's always tampering and tinkering and getting
these systems.
Yeah, they need the message.
Plenty of that in there, I think you'll find.
Oh, yeah. Too much, actually. It's absorbing one time. And that's what I was
there, there are plenty of people that tell us that they can't.
I'd like to meet those people.
I think I heard a message before. I'm driving
by. Hey, who are you?
Are you going to the bathroom yet? He's
going to the
bathroom.
That's a
But that that they're really
I'm giving it just a moment. See what
everybody
can
do.
I forgot to
see
that
they're about absolutely does not. It teaches against
that's
it.
That's right.
It teaches against the sinner's prayer. They called the Pharisee called Jesus a sinner. He said, the blind man said,
still preaching.
Thank God, here's not sinners.
Still preaching.
Oh, preaching.
Oh, yeah. Still preaching.
You're off your sin. Hey, God, what should God do?
It's a challenge.
You don't start praying to a God that you don't believe in, do you?
Now they like walk around and
go, oh, you don't start praying to a God that you don't believe in.
See, I'm like, because we're like, yes, you know, Christmas, we don't do it.
Why not this?
So they're making a joke about it.
So
there's one making a joke that we're into.
They're going to hate you for something.
Believe God if they're paying attention. It's
possible.
It's still, and it's going to be something they work on pretty slow. If you grow, you get strong.
Well, it's the way you say
it. The other day, we were my wife and I were yesterday, actually.
Just the church.
And we the lady that was
just dropping
said, oh, yeah, you know, working here to, you know, pay for my daughter's, you know, Christmas and birthday that's coming up. And I was
watching.
And I was like, well, I was like, I don't know if you go to church or anything. He's judging her. If you're Jeremiah, as a prophet, there's your Israel.
And that's good. If you got a peace offering problem,
we're banned. We can get that back. Silver and gold shield. Well, good thing I bought it. I always buy a fake tree.
Oh, I was like, you didn't even get it.
Zoom!
Wow. Yeah, it went wow.
And the lady behind us, though, goes, didn't that have, like, come out of some kind of, like, Egyptian fire worship? I was like, well, it goes even further than that. But yes, it does. She said, sex worship.
Yeah.
But,
somebody's going to benefit from it, you know.
Christian. Yeah, this one won't hear it, but this one's kind of
hurting him. Hey, I like what you said.
We'll take him instead.
Yeah.
What is that?
I love it. That's all part of those that many calls.
That's almost like a
trick. It's almost like
and a trick. Well, good thing I buy a big tree.
Yeah.
That's
kind of funny.
I hadn't heard that from the gospel.
Yeah,
the
custom,
not the fact that it was a real tree.
Yeah,
the custom of decorating a tree and putting it in your house. At least on my face.
You don't want to see a place.
What do you pray for?
That is a personal prayer.
I like that.
I
know this sounds hard for somebody who's doing this.
You ready? Are you ready? You ready? For them?
Go eat, yeah. I pick up my cross.
I say it's easy.
Where is it? The wheel's off, so I can't drag it anymore. The bar is too heavy.
Yeah.
So just put it in a trunk. Right, I folded it up.
Right? Yeah. Is this the, can I get a sign? Simeon, maybe?
Yeah. Let me tell you where you go. I don't ever go myself.
Studies?
Oh,
you guys still do that over at the house? Or?
Oh, okay. That's a picture of
Fish.
Yeah.
I go Wednesday after
But that's just what we do.
Just a suggestion. What about now?
I don't think that dog's ever seen a bad day. But guys,
alrighty.
Here we go.
Oh.
I'll probably be shortly behind you.
Did everybody just walk up? Did everybody in the world get hit?
Oh, the start of the
go copy of the message.
No,
it is.
Oh, Very shortly. Chili's up to 11. 11 plus. We get our order.
I thought he was like ready, ready. It's hard to read his facial expressions.
Thank you. Mary's needs to go with it.
I always go
into church. Where did Dave go?
Dave left, I think. Several minutes ago.
I wanted him to wait a minute.
Getting things ready. Yeah.
By the way, I went to that conference in Illinois, not Delaware. Yeah. That's where a guy told me what we need to do to get our videos up on the website.
To get them working right. We need to get
it. Meeting with the engineer tomorrow, God willing. Here, tomorrow. Get that done. God willing.
When do you guys got to go by?
Tomorrow morning.
Wow.
I actually called.
I have to go do some shopping. I got to get this stuff together. Well, I know that's a hard message.
So welcome to
that fellow here that was really wrestling with it. I could see it. He was real fidgety. Extremely fidgety. So I thought I better recover some things. It don't matter the good and the evil is ordained by God.
You can't do anything
to make yourself righteous. You can't do anything to make yourself righteous after you belong to God, after you're a believer. So the point is, He'll make you so miserable you wish you had done right. He'll make your life just a total wreck. And that's what He does to His people. It's not worth fighting Him. If you think He can't hit hard, I mean, it ain't like a two-week headache. He'll hit you more hard than Mike Tyson ever thought of hitting. He's the living God, and He hits like a freight train, and He'll put you right on your deathbed and make you quadriplegic and make you wish, oh, God, please, don't hit me again, and I'll get my mind right. I always think of Cool-Hand Luke. You got my mind right. He's just falling down. You ever seen Cool-Hand Luke?
I sure haven't.
It's funny, it's with Paul Newman. Luke's in prison. The bosses are beating him up. He falls down on his knees, and he's supposed to be the big hero that can take anything from the bosses and not give in. And all the guys are watching him from the outside of prison, from inside the prison, inside their cells. It's like the scene is the 1930s. And when he falls down and says, I got my mind right, boss. They're all disappointed. They won't talk to him and comes back in because he's kind of a rebellious hero. Then when he breaks loose again, then George Kennedy is playing opposite him. He says, I knew you said you got your mind right. You didn't really mean it. He said, man, they broke me. But he said, they didn't go get me from breaking loose again. But it really reminds me of what God does to His believers. He will get your mind right. And you won't do it. But He will. Everything that's going on is of God. When you think you can get by with sin, you can't. God will hurt you so bad you won't think it. You won't ever believe He can hurt you like that. He'll do things to your body that you can't get away. When God will completely disable a man and put him in a hospital where he can't move and he's dying and he has no will. If you got free will, try getting up out of bed like that. Try to get off your deathbed. You got free will, do it. You think you can't? And those of us that are believers, the longer we stay in the city, the harder we get, the tougher God gets on us till He just nearly just kills us. And that's when you put your hands in there and say, I give up, Lord, I surrender. I'm not going to rebel against you anymore. I'm tired of me. And y'all are young. It's hard. I only say these things so all the people don't have to go through as much rebellion as I did. I went through, I didn't have nobody teaching.
Titus have too.
I rebelled. Up to God. Oh, I was a believer, I thought. Well, I was elect, but I wasn't acting right, you know.
So do we just pray?
Come on, Mr. God Brown.
You pray for guidance that God will, you pray that God will give you strength to live the way you should instead of having to be broken, because God will break his people. He'll break us, and he's broken me. He's broken me till he just about killed me. It's a hard thing for God. When the Bible says it's a fearful thing to fall in the hands of an angry God, he's talking to believers in the 10th chapter of Hebrews. He ain't talking to unbelievers. It's very frightening to fall into God's hands as a believer, thinking I can get by with this. No, you can't.
Nope. Not one thing.
It beats with an inch of life and makes it so miserable.
You can be sure your sins will find you out.
And they will. They always will. Mine always have found me out. And yours will find you out.
Yep. Mine too. Come on, pack fast before they close.
We gotta go to the store. I wish you guys had more time to stick around.
Well, all in God's time.
Well, be thankful for what you got.
Yeah. I'm so... The events that had to line up for us to be selected at work to come all the way out here to get these trucks is phenomenal.
Really?
The amount of things that had to add up. One, Servpro had to have started here in Gallatin, Tennessee almost 80 years ago.
Yeah.
Two, I had to have ended up going back to a company doing work that I didn't really enjoy, but I know that it is necessary in order to keep a job.